This is Easy Gamer's idea of what you really need if you want to do gaming at T108. Basically, what we've done is we went and did a lot of research and decided at this point, this is the best value for money that you can get if you want something that really will last you a long time and you want to be able to do some P108 gaming. This is not designed to be run everything at maximum at P108. For that, you would need to upgrade the graphics card. But it is a setup which is based on our Good Place to Start computer, which basically allows you to scale the computer however you want by just adding more RAM or graphics card. What we have here is we've got our new favorite case, the Cooler Master MasterCase 5 Pro. It's an excellent, very versatile case. It's modular. You'll see all the little bits and pieces when we get inside. It's a nice, clean-looking case. It's easy to carry. It's got two handles. It's got dust filters. Makes for a nice, neat setup and one that'll probably last you for a very, very, very long time. Then, power supply unit. We went for the Corsair VS550. It's a sort of a mid-range power supply unit. It's a very neat setup. One of the main reasons we went for it, it's a very quiet power supply unit. Under 50% usage, it makes virtually no detectable noise. It's really a very, very nice and silent PSU. And the main reason is it's got a big 12-volt rail. So you've got enough 12-volt to be able to take up to your largest graphics card that's currently available, basically. Then, motherboard. Gigabyte Z170 XP SLI. Again, great value for money. Excellent card in terms of backwards compatibility and forwards compatibility. We'll show you a bit more detail on that when we get inside. Corsair Vengeance LPX DDR4 2400. We only use 8 gig DIMMs. It's available with 1 or 2 DIMMs. We recommend taking 2 like we have in this build. Because as soon as you go to 2 DIMMs, you're running in dual channel RAM. Why we're using 8 gig and not 4 gig DIMMs is so you have the option to upgrade to 32 gig later on if you want. Again, the whole idea behind this build is to give you something that really is future compatible. At this stage, 16 gig RAM is more than enough for basically any of the games. But we've seen a trend starting with things like Ashes of the Singularity, where they really start to use more resources, especially when you're looking at using DirectX 12, which you get with Windows 10. On the CPU side, we have the Core i5-6600. A lot of people say, no, why don't you use an i7? Big price difference, firstly. And if you're not going to be overclocking the machine, and you're not using the K processors, the only thing you really get is a tiny bit of clock speed, and you're getting hyper-threading. For gaming, hyper-threading doesn't really help. Basically, what hyper-threading is normally you have, if you have a 4-core CPU, the Windows can send 4 sets of instructions to the CPU, 1 per core. Hyper-threading lets you send 2 per core. In Windows, it looks like you have 8 cores. It's actually only 4. Some people say that it's 8, but it's not. It's just 2 ways into the core. Where you get a benefit from that is from some of the professional programs and things like video editing. We honestly don't feel it's needed for gaming. So we'd rather save a bit of money and go for this processor. To put this processor in perspective, if you're someone that comes from laptop gaming, any of the U processors is normally, if it's i5 or an i7, is a 15 watt processor, which gives you an idea of what the maximum power is that they can use. For similar generation, you normally have a similar power efficient, a similar performance per watt throughout the range. You get some laptops with 45 watt processors, but they're rare. We do offer some of them as well, which really give you almost desktop level performance. But this processor is a 65 watt processor. So compared to most laptops, even if the laptop says it's an i7, you've actually got almost 4 times the processing power on this CPU. So don't get put off by the fact that it's called an i5. you can go, if you want to do overclocking, you can go to a 600-700K, which is a processor which is a 91 watt. So it is a nice step up in terms of your thermal headroom, and you can do a bit of overclocking and get more speed. But to put it in perspective, for most single-threaded tasks or lightly-threaded tasks, which most current games are, this little i5 here actually fares fairly well compared to my personal one, which is a 4960X, which is the 140-watt 6-core i7 processor. And for single-threaded things, this one really, in some cases, actually beats it. So don't be turned off by the fact that it's an i5. It's actually a very, very powerful little processor. And then, finally, the thing that actually gets you to do some more gaming on this rig is your GeForce GTX 950. We went for the Gigabyte Extreme Gaming. Gigabyte basically has the normal ones, which is similar to the NVIDIA reference ones. Then they have the G1 Gaming, which is their overclocked version. And then when they really got the hang of everything and said, well, okay, how can we improve it even further, they bring out an Extreme Gaming version. What you get with this is it basically gives you, near as makes no difference to the performance of a 960. It's a 20% overclock from the factory compared to the normal 950. So you've got 20% more performance than you'd get from a 950, which is a few rand cheaper. But overall, we feel this is about the best value point you can get. In terms of what you can expect for gaming, you can scroll down a bit and have a look at our actual tests and see what you really will get. But on relatively low settings, you can run things like Battlefield 4, like Ashes of Singularity. We've actually run and struggled a little on that one. Most of the modern shooter games and strategy games work quite well. It isn't a quad where you could really crank it up on at P1080. If you're running a lower resolution, you can, then there's a bit more headroom. But it is sort of the minimum graphics card that we'd recommend if you want to just be able to play all of the games. Things like GTA and so on works really well. GTA 5 works really, really well as well. But have a look at the other video to get a good idea of what it's really capable of. But okay, so let's delve into what's actually going on in here. Looking at the case itself, one of the very important things to take into account is, can you physically move it? This one's very easy. Got two handles built into the case at the top here. Will everything clog up with dust? Is one which, trust me, from experience is very important. In this case, you just clip out. Dust filters from the front, from the top. And for the power supply unit, and then you can clean them. Keeps everything on the inside much cleaner. Makes for a nice, much nicer computer if you ever have to work on it or want to upgrade it. Anything if you want to get inside, nice and simple. Loosen two screws. Look, there goes the side panel. And then we can have a look at what is actually going on the inside here. So let's start from the bottom up. Here's your Corsair power supply. It's a very nice, neat installation. Matches the color of the case as well. At the bottom here, you've got quick release drive bays, two of them, which can either take SSDs or normal hard drives. The trays themselves actually clip into the normal hard drives and have got screw slots for the smaller size ones like the SSDs. What's nice is this little box here actually contains extra screws and extra brackets for everything you can possibly think of that you might want to do with the case. Over here we've got our base hard drive which we use for our builds. This is a SSHD, so this is sort of a hybrid between a normal hard drive and a SSD. It's a lot quicker than what using a normal hard drive is, but in practice what we found is about a third of the speed of a proper SSD. So we'd still really strongly recommend adding at least a SSD for the operating systems and the games you really want to play often, because it's a night and day difference using a SSD. The nice thing with this, it's got an 8 gig SSD built onto it. So things like the operating system and one or two games which you play very often will actually run a lot quicker than the normal programs just running from the hard drive. Over here, we've got two slots for SSDs specifically, which is it actually, you open it and it just slides in there. They can also be mounted at the back of the motherboard if you don't want them here, or if you want the space for more graphics cards or expansion slots. The motherboard comes with a very, very nice sound card built into it. It's the amp up audio. It's actually isolated from the rest of the motherboard, so you get no interference. It's a great thing. Most audiophiles really like the specific implementation of the sound card, so that's taken into consideration. Over here on this side, you've got six SATA, 6 gigabits per second ports. The very nice thing with this motherboard for future compatibility is all these ones actually have an extra little plug next to them, which makes them the six ports can either function as that or as free SATA Express ports. The time of making this video, SATA Express hard drives aren't available, but it's really going to make a huge difference in the performance of the computer, as all my computers run on SSDs, and without exception, they're all limited by the SATA, normal SATA port. This one would be 16 gigabits per second instead of the 6, so you're getting 3 times the performance almost when that becomes available on the market. Here we've got the 950 Extreme Gaming in place. It's a really nice sturdy card. It's a nice looking card. At the top here, you've got Windforce LEDs for when it's running. It's sort of high load. And then if it's running a lower load, it actually say fan stop and silent. And these LEDs colors can be customized via software that comes with the card. The very nice thing is, for sort of basic games like Dota and that, you can actually get it to run without using the fans. And the same thing on the power supply. The power supply goes into super quiet mode, and then the computer makes virtually no noise. It's actually really nice for gaming. If it doesn't sound like a computer's a tornado that wants to take off. This is just the power connector for it. You'll see if you're running a smaller card like this, you've actually got a secondary connector. It's nice. We've tested my 980 Ti G1 Gaming in here. The power supply can run it, and you have got the connectors for it. So it's a straight swap. Just buy a different card, fits in here. The Turbo B clock you'd see just above that is for overclocking. The specific CPU in this build is not an overclocking CPU, but if you want to upgrade later, or if you decide to go rather for the 6700K, that is a nice option to have. The CPUs on the 14 nanometer construction means it's incredibly power efficient. So the standard Intel cooler, we've never actually been able to get it to get to temperatures which we don't like on the standard cooler, so that's sufficient, saves a bit of money. So we kept the standard cooler in here. Here's our RAM. This specific build, we're running 16 gig in dual channel, which would be the setup that we'd recommend. You'll see all the cables are actually running through to the back of the case and running down and coming out in this area here to connect to the power supply, which gives you a very nice, neat setup. These drive bays, you just unscrew here and here, and you can actually remove it or move it at any point if you want to fit a longer cord, like the 980 Ti, for example. The G1 Gaming one is just too long to fit with the drive bay, so you have to either put it under the drive bay or move the drive bay out of the way. In terms of building a serious rig, you've got a M.2 slot there, which is a 32 gigabit slot. That's for the onboard SSDs. If you're looking to get one of those, it's the MVE ones you're looking for if you want the serious speed. They are very expensive, but there's just no speed comparison. They're by far the quickest drives you can get, and it's something people often overlook. That's why we only started with the SSHD and not with a normal hard drive. Your hard drive speed actually makes the biggest noticeable difference in performance on the computer, except for the graphics card if you're looking at gaming. But really recommend going for the SSD. Once you have one, you'll see what the same thing will happen to you. That what happened to me is you can't work on a computer that doesn't have one. It frustrates you because it just feels like it's ancient technology. So that is definitely something to look at. And if you want to go all out, as I said, you've got that upgrade slot for the more serious ones. Everything on the motherboard comes, all the important bits is heatsink protected. You've actually got three PCI Express 16 slots. You've got two just normal PCI slots, although the one is blocked by the graphics card if it's installed in this slot, but you can move the graphics card to a different slot. And you've got two actual PCI slots as well. So if you have an old wireless card which you'd still want to use, you actually still have the connectivity for that. And on the inside, the only other thing I could think of to mention is we've actually hooked up the fans to run from the motherboard's controls. So the motherboard actually controls the temperature in the case. Again, under light loads, that really helps keep the computer very, very nice and quiet. On the back panel here, it gets quite interesting. Graphics card, quite simple. You've got DVI, HDMI, and three display ports. But the motherboard is what's a really nice touch here, because you've got some serious backwards and forwards compatibility. You've actually still got a PS2 port for old keyboard and mouse. You've got connectors here for the onboard graphics, which in this case is a bit irrelevant. You've got six audio jacks. You've got a gigabit LAN. You've got three USB 3 ports of the Type A connectors. The very nice thing here is this red one is a 3.1 Type A port, which is double the bandwidth. For future devices, that's a very, very nice thing to have. And right above it, you've actually got a USB 3.1 Type-C connector, which is the reversible connector, which would be replacing micro USB, and that a lot of devices are starting to adopt. And really, it's one of those things which most computers today don't have, and you're really going to miss if you don't have it, if you build a computer today. And really helps with keeping the computer compatible for the future. So, in summary, if you're looking for a computer just to be able to play some games at P1080, and you're looking for something that's going to last you a long time and you can upgrade as you go along, this is really an excellent option. As I said, we've done a lot of research to make sure that we pick the best of everything for this situation, and we really feel, in terms of a value point, this might not be the cheapest in the market, but the way we spent the extra money, we really feel it's worth it, and we believe you will too. Thank you.